Greetings, students, and welcome to this brief lesson on the principles of reasoning and how to detect fallacies. Let's begin. First, if we were in a classroom setting, I would show you a few commercials and ask you to evaluate them. I would ask you, what are they trying to sell, which is pretty obvious, but the harder question is how they're trying to sell it and what they assume about the audience or the viewer when they sell it in the way that they do. Presumably, someone who's trying to get you to buy something should have a good argument or a good reason why you should buy that product, right? So what is their argument for taking your money? How strong is that argument? And then finally, how do you feel watching it? Because oftentimes feelings can impact our evaluation of an argument, and maybe they shouldn't, right? So there are all kinds of cases of bad reasoning where people are using bad reasoning because they know it will impact you and me and everyone else who partakes in the media. They know it'll impact us in certain ways. And so we have all kinds of contemporary cases of bad reasoning that a lesson like this is intended to address. There are conspiracy theories. There are vulnerable consumers. There is manipulation by social media companies. And our leaders, our politicians, are simply being untruthful a lot of the times. And so a lesson like this on the principles of reasoning and detecting fallacies is actually kind of a defense against the dark arts sort of lesson. That's what we're engaged in a lesson like this. All right, let's do some preliminaries. First, let's review, as I mentioned in one of my other lessons about logic and philosophy. Logic is basically your toolbox for all subjects, including philosophy, but not limited to it, right? If you have an understanding of the way logic works, of the way arguments work, you are in a position to evaluate the things that people are saying to you. And philosophy I defined as thinking critically about the questions that matter. And so logic is your toolbox for that. But it's also your toolbox for other subjects as well, right? If someone tries to present you with an idea in history or in sociology or in science even, logic is how those arguments are addressed. And so we need to pay attention to it. And so as you enter this conversation, take stock of who you are, where we are in history. And remember, you're entering a conversation about the world's most difficult intellectual problems, and the greatest thinkers in human history have dealt with these. For example, Socrates was maybe one of the most important figures in human history, because he showed people that there are a lot of times that we have assumptions that we're not questioning, right? And he didn't always have the answers. In fact, he said, I'm the smartest man in the world because I at least know that I know very little or nothing. So that's Socrates, but Socrates taught people. And one of the people he taught was Plato, who didn't agree with Socrates on everything. Certainly most things, of course, but not everything. Plato comes along, and as a student of Socrates, Plato writes down a lot of what Socrates said. There are things he adds to the record that may or may not come from Socrates. But by and large, Socrates is Plato's most important character in most of his writings. He basically puts Socrates in dialogue with other thinkers back then. And Plato is, I think, the most important philosopher in the Western tradition, bar none. He is the most important philosopher. He kind of set the table, and everyone else has been dealing with it ever since, right? He presented the questions that we've all been trying to answer for the last 2,500 years. But even Plato is not the final word. You're entering an ongoing conversation, and so Plato had a school, and one of his students was Aristotle, who disagreed with him on not minor things. Plato sort of disagreed with Socrates on some minor things. Aristotle disagreed with Plato on some pretty significant things, right? And so it's okay to disagree. disagreement is not a bad thing. It's a good thing. Iron sharpens iron here, right? So Socrates taught Plato, Plato taught Aristotle, and this is the conversation you're entering now. So buckle up. As far as definitions, when we talk in this lesson and others about critical thinking, one thing I want to emphasize is we're talking about reflective thinking. Critical doesn't mean mean-spirited or angry, right? That doesn't need to be how we understand critical thinking. Critical thinking is just big picture, reflective thinking. Critical thinking is not afraid to ask if all of my own beliefs are justified, whether they make sense. I might believe things that are not justified, right? A critical thinker is able to ask about the beliefs we hold. Also, let's have a definition for the word argument, because when people hear argument, just like with the word critical, they form judgments about what that means. You hear argument, you might be thinking about something that, you know, a disagreement over the Thanksgiving Day dinner. But that's not how philosophers use the word argument. An argument is basically any suggestion to someone else to believe something or do something for a reason. And those reasons are usually called premises, right? So if you have a premise, that is a reason for something, or it's background information that is trying to convince you of a certain conclusion. So every argument has a premise, and every argument has a conclusion. There's no argument that just has a statement. That's just a proposition, right? An argument requires reasons and a conclusion. Two more definitions. Valid and sound. If we talk about valid arguments, that means that the form of the argument works. It can be about total nonsense, but the form of the argument works. And so imagine you're back in junior high, you're learning about doing math with variables, right? You can insert different variables into different kinds of math problems, but the math still works whether you put an X there or a Y there. It doesn't matter, right? Because the form of the math problem means that it works. Valid is kind of like that. It refers to the form of the argument, and an argument is valid when the form works. We'll say more about that in a second. Sound refers to the truth of the argument. If the statements are true and not false, then you can refer to that argument as a sound argument. Now notice, you can't have a sound argument that is also invalid. And so if it's a valid argument, then you ask the question about whether it's a sound argument. But if it's invalid, then it cannot be a sound argument. Finally, let's talk about deduction versus induction, and we'll say more about this in a second. Deductive reasoning leads to certain conclusions if the argument is valid and sound. In other words, deductive reasoning is like that math problem where the answer has to be a certain way. It's certain. Inductive reasoning is often not that, right? It leads to probable conclusions, but they're not certain. They're just probable. Let me explain some more. All right, deductive arguments, like I just said, they deal with certainty, and the form matters a great deal for validity. So look at this example. All blondes are undercover geniuses. Mandy is a blonde. Therefore, Mandy is an undercover genius. Now, this is a stupid argument. It doesn't make much sense, right? But look at the form. All blondes, so let's say all B, are undercover geniuses. Let's call that G. All B are G. Mandy, let's call her M, is a B. Therefore, Mandy is an undercover genius. The form of that argument means that the conclusion, which is the part that starts with therefore, has to be true if the two premises that precede it are true. If it's true that all blondes are undercover geniuses, and if it's true that Mandy is a blonde, it has to be the case that Mandy is an undercover genius. Even though these phrases like blondes as undercover geniuses, it's ridiculous. But the form of the argument means that if the premises are true, the conclusion has to be true. That's deductive reasoning. Now, contrast that with inductive arguments. These deal with probability, not with certainty. And so the reasons you offer, they matter a great deal to increase the probability of the conclusion that you're building towards. So here's an example. I'm not a drinker much, but if I notice that rum and Coke makes me sick, and if the next day I notice that rum and Sprite makes me sick, and if the next day I notice that rum and Mountain Dew makes me sick, after a while I can kind of arrive at sort of this predictive probability that rum probably makes me sick. You know, it's probably not the Coke, it's probably not the Sprite or the Mountain Dew, it's probably the rum, because that's the consistent ingredient in the times when I got sick. Therefore, rum probably makes me sick. And the more drinks I drink that have rum and a different, additional drink that make me sick, the greater the likelihood that rum makes me sick. You understand the difference between inductive arguments, which deal with probability, which you can increase through the addition of more examples or more evidence in favor of conclusion. That's inductive argumentation versus deductive argumentation, which deals with certainty because it's about the form of the argument. All right, moving on. Preliminaries. As you engage with different arguments in a class like this, there are a number of technical ways to evaluate arguments in symbolic logic, etc. But as a preliminary, I think all of us are equipped to at least kind of do a sniff test of an argument, right? We can tell, I think, by and large, that certain things don't pass the sniff test. And so a preliminary test for arguments is, does it ring truthful to you? Does it ring truthful? Does it smack of logical strength? Are there a lot of reasons given for a certain position? Is the argument and are the reasons offered even relevant towards the conclusion they want you to accept? That's the test of relevance. And then finally, one of the most interesting is the test of non-circularity. If someone, and we'll say more about this later, but if someone is advancing an argument and one of their premises or reasons for accepting the argument, the conclusion, is the same as the conclusion itself, that's a problem. That's circular reasoning. And you can see the problem here. Circular reasoning works because circular reasoning works because circular right? You can see how this works. It's bad logic to use circular reasoning. So these are just kind of some quick tests. When you're presented with an argument, you could do this, and there are obviously more sophisticated ways to evaluate arguments. And sometimes things can seem true that aren't. Of course, that happens. But these are kind of preliminary tests. When you're exposed to an argument, these should be four tests that you can put that argument through. All right, let's talk about more examples of deductive and inductive reasoning. First, we're going to talk about deductive reasoning about declarative statements. So what is a declarative statement? It's basically a proposition. It declares something. And one way to do this is to affirm the antecedent. Now, you'll notice in arguments sometimes you're going to see these two words, antecedent and consequence. Think of the antecedent as an A part of the argument. So if A, then B. The antecedent is the A part, and that's how you can remember it. This has a fancy Latin phrase, modus ponens. You don't need to know that. What you do need to know is this is affirming the antecedent. And in an if-then statement, the antecedent is the A part of that. If A, then B. Affirming the antecedent happens in the second step. You are affirming A. So if A, then B. Let's affirm A in that second step. Therefore, the conclusion is B. Notice it's deductive. The conclusion has to be true if those two premises are true. If A, then B. Affirm A, therefore B has to be true. That's deductive reasoning about a declarative statement. Another way to do this is to deny the consequence. And this is known as modus tollens. You don't need to know that. But here's how it would work. There's your sentence again with the antecedent and the consequence. In this case, the consequence is B. So if A, if the antecedent, then B, the consequence. We are going to deny that consequence, not B. So if A, then B, not B, therefore not A. The conclusion has to be that. If you're going to deny the consequence, the conclusion has to be not A. Does that make sense? Hopefully it does. If it doesn't, feel free to ask me about it, and I would love the opportunity to explain it more. A third example of deductive reasoning about declarative statements is called a disjunctive syllogism. And here's your opening sentence. Here's your first premise. Either A or B, right? Either one. Either A or B. The second step is to say not A. And so your conclusion, you can tell it has to be true, is therefore B. If it's not going to be A, then it has to be B because of that first premise. Either A or B. Not A, therefore B. Notice you could switch it around too. You could say either A or B. Not B, therefore A. Either way works, right? This is a disjunctive syllogism. And those are examples of deductive reasoning about declarative statements. There are other types of deductive reasoning as well. You can do deductive reasoning about classes of objects, right? And I'm sure you've heard of some of these, right? Here's how to apply a generalization. All A are B. S is an A. Therefore, S is a B. This is applying a generalization to a class of objects, right? So you can say all men are mortal, which obviously that's true. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. The conclusion has to be true given the premises and the form of the argument. You can also deductively reason about a class of objects through applying an exception. You could say all A are B, X is not a B, therefore X is not A. Make sense? Okay. Moving on, inductive reasoning, as we mentioned before, is a matter of probability, not certainty. And so there are different ways to do inductive reasoning, and this is one of them. Every A that we've observed so far is also B. Therefore, it's probable that A equals B. This isn't certain, it's just probable. Because every A we've observed so far is also a B. Therefore, A equals B. This is inductive reasoning. It's not certain, but it's probable. Here's an example. If I survey 100 congressmen, congresswomen, and if I find out that all of them took campaign contributions from lobbyists, I could reasonably conclude that it's probable. It's not certain, but it's probable that every member of Congress takes lobbying campaign contributions. Does that make sense? All right. Now, I keep mentioning that it's only probable and not certain because every now and then there is a counterexample that changes the paradigm. And the counterexample I want to mention is black swans. For centuries, the only swans that people saw were white. And so naturally, there developed this sort of public understanding, common knowledge that when you said swan, that meant a white bird, basically a white swan. It wasn't until someone saw a black swan that the paradigm changed and the word swan took on a broader meaning. So there are counterexamples to inductive reasoning, and that's why they're not certain. They're probable until we have compelling contradictory evidence. You can also do inductive reasoning by analogy, and this reasons from the similarity of two objects in many areas to the similarity in another area. So let's say I have a friend named Mary and another friend named Diana, and let's say they have similar tastes in almost everything. The books they read, the art that they like, the music they listen to, the food they eat, the TV they watch. And so let's also say that is the first premise. Let's also say Mary watches a specific show, The Bachelorette. Therefore, we can conclude Diana probably watches The Bachelorette as well. How can we conclude that? Well, because we've already stipulated that Mary and Diana have similar tastes in almost everything. And if Mary likes one, the chances are that Diana does too. It's not certain, but it is probable. All right, last thing I'm going to say before we take a quick break is that there are plenty of examples of reasoning, whether it's deductive or inductive, that goes wrong. The easy answer is that good reasoning goes bad because it's not cogent. And it's not cogent because it does one of, you know, a number of things. Maybe it suppresses evidence or contains a questionable premise or the form is invalid. And I want to suggest, before you go to the second part of this video, I want to suggest that knowing about reasoning gone wrong, and another word for this is fallacies, I want to suggest that this may change the way you interact with your world, because people count on you misunderstanding the logic of situations. They count on it. They plan for it, right? They spend a lot of money to get you to accept certain fallacies. And when we talk about some of this stuff, it may change the way you interact with the world. All right, I'm going to wrap this part up and you can go to part 2 and watch the rest of it there.